We are here today in the birthplace of orangism, in Dan Winter's cottage at the Diamond in Rathgall. It was here in 1795 that the Ulster Protestants rallied and fought to defend their homes and their families. They fought against the Irish Papists, who had without provocation rose up and attacked them. You see, the Protestants of 1795 had learned something, something that tragically and very dangerously has been lost to this generation. They had learned the lessons from 1641. It is this slaughter of 1641 that we are looking at today. The massacre of 1641 was one of the foulest deeds ever perpetrated in all the dark and bloodthirsty history of Ireland. It was on the 23rd of October of that year, at the Roman Catholic feast of St. Ignatius Loyola, founder of the Jesuit order, that in Ireland and the northern province of Ulster in particular, experienced a slaughter no less cruel in its nature or tragic in its consequences than that which had taken place some 70 years earlier on St. Bartholomew's Eve in Paris and throughout France. On that terrible October Saturday, the native Irish Papists, led by Sir Phelan O'Neill and incited, encouraged, financed and aided and abetted by the Roman Catholic Church, its priests and its hierarchy, rose up in an insurrection, the sole purpose of which was the eradication of Protestants and Protestantism throughout the Emerald Isle. All that had been accomplished in the preceding decades since the plantation of Ulster, all spiritually, politically and economically, was to be wiped out by fire and the sword. Some four centuries later, and the war of genocide is still being waged by the Irish Republican terrorists. Little has changed, with the exception of the weaponry. Swords and pikes have been replaced by bombs and bullets supplied by Libya and nations of the communist world. The sad fact is that today the events of 1641 are largely forgotten. They have become censored history. Whilst it is impossible to erase from the pages of our history books the events such as the Siege of Derry or the Battle of the Boyne, although every effort has been made by our enemies to minimise, belittle and misrepresent these events, the massacre of 1641 has suffered a historical blackout. Our people are unlikely to hear of the facts from church pulpits where ecumenical and apostate clergy continually tell their flocks that we must forget our unhappy divisions. Our children will definitely not hear of this major event which influenced all Ulster history thereafter. For in our schools today, by the state-enforced education for mutual understanding, so-called, every effort is being made to emphasise our supposedly shared culture and heritage, thereby accelerating the process of de-Protestantization in the preparation for the final push towards what could only be classed as a united Roman Catholic dominated Irish Republic. It is therefore essential that the facts of our history are once again made available to the Protestant population. For it is true to say that a nation, our people, that do not learn from the experience of past events are more than too often condemned to relive those same experiences. There are three major historical accounts of 1641 massacre, which we have used as source material. It is from these three reliable accounts that we have compiled the following record of the massacre. The design of this horrid conspiracy was that a general insurrection should take place at the same time throughout the kingdom, and that all Protestants without exception should be murdered. The day fixed for this horrid massacre was the 23rd of October, 1641, at the feast of St. Ignatius Loyola, founder of the Jesuits. The conspiracy was in arms all over the kingdom,
early in the morning of the day appointed, and every Protestant who fell in their way was immediately murdered. No sex, no age, and no condition was spared. The wife weeping for her husband and embracing her helpless children was pierced with them and perished by the same stroke. The old, the young, the vigorous, and the infirm all underwent the same fate and were blended in one common room. In vain they did fight, except from the first assault. Destruction was let loose everywhere. Without provocation and without opposition, the astonished Protestants, living in profound peace and, as they thought, full security, were massacred by their nearest neighbours, with whom they had long maintained a continued intercourse of kindness. Even death was the slightest punishment inflicted by these monsters in human form. All the tortures which wanton cruelty could invent, all the lingering pains of body, the anguish of mind, the agonies of despair, depraved nature, even perverted religion, cannot reach to a greater pitch of ferocity than appeared in these merciless barbarians. The very children taught by example and encouraged by exhortation of their parents dealt their blows on the dead carcasses of defenseless children of the Protestants. The bigoted and merciless papists had no sooner begun to imbue their hands in blood than they repeated their horrid tragedy day after day. The Protestants in all parts fell victim to their fury by deaths of the most unheard of cruelty. The ignorant Irish were more strongly instigated to execute the infernal business by the Jesuits, priests and friars, who when the day for the execution of the plot was agreed on, recommended in their prayers diligence in the great design, which they said would greatly tend to the prosperity of the kingdom and add to the advancement of the Catholic cause. They everywhere declared to the common people that the Protestants were heretics and ought not to be suffered to live among them any longer, adding that it was no greater a sin to kill one than to kill a dog, and that the relieving or protecting of them was a crime of the most unpardonable nature. The papists, having besieged the town and castle of Longford, and the inhabitants, who were Protestants, having suffered on condition of being allowed quarter or mercy, the instant the townspeople appeared, attacked them in a most unmerciful manner. Their priest, as a signal for the rest, first ripping open the belly of a Protestant minister, after which his followers murdered all the rest, some of whom they hung, others were stabbed or shot. A great number were knocked on the head with axes, which were provided for the purpose. The garrison at Sligo was treated in like manner by O'Connor Sligo, who upon the Protestants quitting their holds, promised them quarter or mercy, but imprisoned them in a loathsome jail, allowing them only grains for their food. Those Protestants who survived were brought forth by the white friars, and were either killed or precipitated over the bridge into the Swift River, where they soon were destroyed. It is added that this wicked company of white friars went in some time later in solemn procession with holy water in their hands to sprinkle the river and cleanse it from the pollution of the blood and the dead bodies of the heretics, as they call the unfortunate Protestants who were inhumanly slaughtered at this time. At Kilmore, the bishop, Dr. Bedell, his two sons and the rest of his family, along with some of the chief of the Protestants, whom he had protected, were forced into a ruinous castle called Lochwater, situated in a lake near the sea. Here they remained for some weeks, daily expecting to be put to death. The greater part of them were stripped naked, by which means the season was cold, it being December, and the building in which they were confined, open at the top, they endured the most severe hardships. In Barony of Tyrolay, the Papists, at the instigation of their friars, compelled more than 40 English Protestants, some of whom were women and children, to the hard fate of either falling by the sword or drowning in the sea. Those choosing the latter were forced by weapons of their persecutors into the deep, where with their children in their arms, they first waded up to their chins and afterwards sank down and perished together. In the castle of Lisgoole, upwards of 150 men, women and children were all burnt together, and at the castle of Mona, not less than 100 were put to the sword. Great numbers were also murdered at the castle of Tulla. Many others were put to deaths of the most horrid nature, and such as could only have been invented by demons instead of men. Some of them were led with their backs on the axle tree of a carriage, with their legs resting on the ground one side, and their arms and head on the other. In this position, one of the savages scourged the wretched victims, while another set on furious dogs who tore to pieces the arms and upper parts of the body, and in this way they were deprived of existence. Great numbers were fastened to horses' tails, and the beasts being set on full gallop by their riders, the wretched victims were dragged along until they expired. Others were hung on a lofty gibbet, and the fire being kindled under them, they finished their lives partly by hanging and partly by suffocation. Nor did the more tender sex escape the least particle of the cruelty that could be projected by their merciless and furious persecutors. Many women of all ages were put to deaths of the most cruel nature. Some in particular were fastened with their backs to strong posts, and being stripped, the inhumane monsters cut off their right breasts with shears, which of course put them to the most excruciating torments. And in this position, they were left until, from the loss of blood, they expired.
Such was the savage veracity of these barbarians, that even unborn infants were dragged from the womb to become victims of their rage. Many unhappy mothers were hung naked on the branches of trees, and their bodies being cut open, the innocent offspring being taken from them and thrown to dogs and swine. And to increase the horrid scene, they would often oblige the husband to be a spectator before he suffered himself. At the town of Lisnaskee, they hanged about 100 Scottish Protestants. Maguire commanded the governor of the castle to hear mass, and to complete his horrid barbarities, he ordered his wife and his children to be hung before his face before massacring at least 100 of the inhabitants. 4,000 persons were drowned in different places. The inhumane Papists, at first stripping them, drove them like beasts to the spot fixed for their destruction. Any who were slacked in their pace, they pricked with their swords and pikes and murdered along the way. Many of the poor Protestants were thrown into the water, and when they were there they tried to swim to the shore, but their merciless persecutors preventing their endeavours and by shooting them in the water. In one place 140 Protestants, after being driven many miles stark naked and in the most severe weather, were all murdered on the same spot, some being hanged, others burnt, some shot, others buried alive. And so cruel were their tormentors that they would not even suffer them to pray before they were robbed of their miserable existence. When any of them had killed a Protestant, others would come and receive a gratification in cutting and in mangling the body, after which they left it to be devoured by dogs, and when they had slain a number of Protestants, they would boast, that the devil was beholden to them for sending so many souls to hell. All I can tell you is the miserable state we continue under, for the rebels daily increase in men and munition in all parts, except the province of Munster, exercising all manner of cruelties and striving who can be the most barbariously exquisite in tormenting the poor Protestants, cutting off their ears, fingers and hands, plucking out their eyes, boiling the hands of little children before their mothers' faces, stripping women naked and ripping them up. The main record I ever of this terrible occurrence is furnished by Sir John Temple, Master of the Rolls at the time, who collected and published in a book form the sworn depositions of many of the witnesses who gave evidence before the Commission of Inquiry. Many of the witnesses had themselves been mutilated, but had survived long enough to give their evidence. Others had a knowledge of the Irish language, by means of which they were able to pass themselves off as Irish and remain unwilling witnesses of the scenes that they describe. 40 volumes of depositions are still preserved at Trinity College in Dublin. The indictment they furnish is truly an appalling one. Sir John says, "If we shall take a survey of primitive times and look at the sufferings of the first Christians that suffered under the tyranny and cruel persecution of those heathenish emperors, we shall certainly not find in any one kingdom where more Christians had suffered or more unparalleled cruelties were enacted in many years than upon them that were in Ireland within the space of the first 2 months after the breaking out of this rebellion. To let in death among an innocent, unprovoking, unresisting people who had always lived peaceably with them, administering all manners of helps and comforts to those who were in distress, that made no difference between them and those of their own nation, but had even cherished them as friends and neighbours, without giving any cause of unkindness or distaste unto them. The crime of the Protestants, however, was not any unneighbourly conduct, but the fact of their presence in a foreign land. They were aliens, and the annihilation of aliens has always been the first item on the officialist nationalist agenda."
It is recorded that 115 men, women and children were conducted by the order of Sir Phelim O'Neill to Portadown Bridge, where they were forced into the river and drowned.
In 1641, those Fenians formed a plan to massacre us Protestants down by the river bank. To massacre us Protestants and not to spare a man, but to drive us down like a herd of swine into the river bend. Brave porter fell a victim because he did intend to help his brother Protestants their lives for to defend. The blood did stain the waters red, their bones lay all around, as they drove them down into the bend that flows through Portadown. A lady living in Loughgull, and with her children fine, she begged for the sake of them to let her be alive, that she might go to England, her husband there to see, and to live in peace peace and unity, and far from popery. But oh, they would not hear her cry, they placed her on the ground. And after having tortured her, the six of them they bound. They said, "You are a heretic, the Pope you do defy, and it's from this bridge in Portadown this day you're doomed to die. At least 100 faithful souls in Portadown were slain. All were the deeds of popery, their wicked ways to gain. But God sent down brave Cromwell, our deliverer to be. And he put down popery in this land, us Protestants set free. King William soon came after him, and planted at the Boyne an orange tree there that we should bear in mind. How popery did murder, us Protestants did drown. The bones of some can still be seen this day in Portadown.
One woman named Campbell, finding no probability of escaping, suddenly clasped one of the chief rebels in her arms and held him so fast or tight that they both drowned together. In Kilimane, they massacred 28 families, among whom 22 burnt together in one house. The rest were hanged, shot, or drowned. Some of the Protestants were set in stocks till they confessed where their money was. After this, they were put to death. The whole country was one common scene of butchery. Thousands perished in a short time by the sword, famine, fire, water, and the most cruel deaths that malice could invent. At Cashel, they put all Protestants into a lonesome dungeon, where they kept them for several weeks in the greatest of misery. At length, they were released to the barbarously mangled and left to die. The papists increased their misery, treating them with derision during their suffering. At Antrim, they murdered 954 Protestants in one day, and afterwards about 1,200 more in that county. At a town called Lisnagarry, they forced 24 Protestants into a house, and then setting fire to it, burnt them, counterfeiting their cries in derision. In Kilkenny, all the Protestants, without exception, were put to death. They beat one woman with such savage barbarity that she had scarce a whole bone left. Afterwards, they threw her into a ditch. But not satisfied with this, they took her child, a girl about 6 years of age, and after ripping up her belly, threw her to her mother, there to languish until they perished. They forced one man to go to mass, after which they ripped open his belly and left him. They sawed another asunder, cut the throat of his wife, and having dashed out the brains of their child, threw his body to the swine, who greedily devoured it. After committing these and many other horrid cruelties, they took the heads of 7 Protestants, one of them a pious minister, all which had set up at the Market Cross. They slit the minister's cheek from ear to ear, and laying a leaf of the Bible before it, bid him preach, for his mouth was wide enough.
These tactics were adopted with complete success by Rory Maguire at Tulla, and at Lisnaskey in County Fermanagh by Phelim O'Neill and his brother Tulla at the Cathedral of Armagh, and by Phil O'Reilly at Belturbet Newton Butler and at Longfield Castle. In every place, all those who surrendered under promise of safe conduct were stripped and butchered.
At Powers Court Church, they burnt Bibles, while some Protestants were dragged by the hair of their heads into the church, where they stripped and whipped them in a most cruel manner. In Munster, they put to death several ministers in the most shocking manner. One they stripped stark naked, and driving him before them, pricked him with swords and pikes till he fell down and expired. In some places they plucked out the eyes and cut off the hands of the Protestants, and in that condition turned them into the fields, there to linger out the remainder of their miserable existence. They obliged young men to force their aged parents to a river where they were drowned, wives to assist in the hanging of their husbands, and mothers to cut the throats of their children. In one place they compelled a young Protestant man to kill his own father, and then they immediately hanged him. In another they forced a woman to kill her husband, and then obliged her son to kill her, and afterwards shot him through the head. At a place called Glasgow, a popish priest prevailed upon 40 Protestants to be reconciled to the Church of Rome, under the vain hope of saving their lives. They had no sooner done this than they, the Papists, cut their throats. In County Tipperary, a great number of Protestants, men, women and children, fell into the hands of the Papists, who, after stripping them naked, murdered them with stones, pole axes, swords and other weapons. In County Mayo, 60 Protestants, including 15 ministers, under the safe conduct to Galway, were stabbed, piked and drowned. At Clonus, 17 men were buried alive. In County Tyrone, 300 Protestants were drowned in one day. Dr. Maxwell, rector of Tyrone, under oath declared that the Irish Papists had destroyed in one place, at Glenwood, 1,200 Protestants in flight from County Armagh. Some Protestants were hung by the feet by tender hooks, driven into poles, and left in that wretched posture to expire. Several were hung on windmills, and before they were half dead, the savages cut them in pieces with their swords. One poor woman they hung on a gibbet, with her child of 12 months old, hung by the neck with the hair of its own mother's head. When estimates afterwards were made of the number who were sacrificed to gratify the diabolical souls of the Papists, it amounted to 150,000. Without any provocation, and equally without any warning, the native Irish, who had given no sign of hostility, rose at a preconceived signal, fell upon the isolated colonists, and stripped them literally to the skin. In this condition, men, women and children were turned out into the cold. All succor and sustenance to the outcast was prohibited under very dire penalties, so that the old and the frail quickly succumbed, and the more vigorous, however, hung on to life by one means or another. At the end of a week, nature's process was voted too slow. The hunting down and butchery of these naked wretches became a recognized form of sport. In its turn, mere killing began to pall, and tortures of various kinds were resorted to. At first, as a means of finding out where the settlers had hidden their money, but later, for the mere sake of torturing. Phelim O'Neill, the head of the movement, after being repulsed from the castle of Ochre, ordered all Protestants in the three adjacent parishes to be at once massacred, irrespective of age or sex. O'Neill, who is described as a weak creature, entirely void of personal courage, invariably signalized his defeats in the field by an indiscriminate massacre of all the helpless victims within reach. After his defeat at Lisburn, he in revenge butchered Lord Caffey, who had just been hospitably entertaining him. The destruction of an entire colony is no light task. Its thorough accomplishment at a period when powder and shot were too good to waste necessitated the free use of fire and water. All the principal rivers that were accessible were called into service. Fire, though obviously less merciful than water, also proved an agent of quick destruction. 150 men, women and children were burnt in the castle of Lisgoole in Fermanagh. 22 in a thatched house at Kilmore in Armagh. 26 at Langale in the same county. And a number in a church at Blackwater Town. The Irish had recourse to their ancient stratagem to offer good condition of quarter or mercy to assure them their lives, their goods and free passage with a safe conduct into what place soever they pleased, and to confirm these covenants sometimes under their hands and seals, sometimes with deep oaths, and then as soon as they had them in their power to hold themselves disobliged from their promises and to leave their soldiers at liberty to despoil, strip and murder them at their pleasure. The apparent disposition on the part of the native Irish to dispatch the earlier of their victims quickly and mercifully was not long lived. After the first big batches of captives had been got rid of by drowning or burning, some very horrid forms of death were devised for small detached parties, the details of which are too revolting to reproduce. Women and children would seem to have been the worst sufferer, and on the side of the native Irish, the gentler sex and even children joined eagerly in the horrid work. Dr. William Petty, who later became Sir William Petty, one of the ablest men of the day, with a marked genius for statistics, reckoned the Protestants in Ireland as numbering 260,000 in 1641 and 150,000 in 1653, a loss in 12 years of 110,000. The priests, in the weekly returns which they furnished from various parishes concerned, claimed 154,000 victims between October 1641 and April 1642. A Cork Roman Catholic priest named Mulhoney published in 1645 an exhortation to his fellow countrymen in which he said, and I quote, "You have killed 150,000 enemies in these 4 or 5 years. As your very adversaries howling, openly confess in their writings, and you do not deny. I think more heretic enemies have been killed. Would that they all had been. It remains for you to slay all other heretics, or expel them from the bounds of Ireland." Close quote. The 1641 massacre may unhesitantly be put down as the most disastrous occurrence in the history of the island. For apart from its own intrinsic horrors, it laid the seeds of an undying distrust among future generations of Protestants. These 12 years proved to be the most devastating Ireland had known. All the worst passions of men were let loose. On top of this came famine and plague, and by the time peace was finally established, nearly one third of the population of Ireland had perished. Scarcely had Ulster been delivered from the tyranny of Strafford when another fiery trial swept over her, the terrible rebellion of 1641. The objects of this outbreak were the extinction of the British power in Ireland and the utter extermination of Protestantism and the establishment of Romanism in its place. Part of the programme was the seizure of Dublin Castle, but fortunately it was saved through the vigilance of a Presbyterian elder, Captain Owen O'Connolly. The force of the insurrection spent itself on Ulster, and here the havoc which it wrought was appalling. No one was prepared for it, and the Protestants, being almost defenceless, were in many cases butchered like sheep. Led on by Sir Phelim O'Neill, the insurgents seized castle after castle, town after town, frequently ruthlessly massacring all the inhabitants. Dungannon, Newry, Monaghan, Dromore, and many other places were thus seized. Fortunately, Enniskillen was secured by Sir William Cole, who also supplied information which saved Derry and Newtown, Limavady. Coleraine too received timely warning and was not only saved, but proved a welcome haven of refuge for many stricken Protestants. Carrickfergus, Lisburn and Belfast also remained untaken, but outside these places, Ulster came a veritable field of blood. Far and wide over the country, the eye beheld towns and villages, the dwelling of the Protestant clergyman, and the farmhouse of the Protestant husbandman, all in flames. Behind hedges and ditches, droves of Protestants, stripped absolutely naked, crouched for shelter, the husband trying in vain to shield his trembling wife, and the mother her wretched children, from the fury of the pitiless assassins and the biting cold of one of the severest winters that could be remembered. The River Blackwater in Tyrone is said to have run red with the blood of murdered Protestants. These atrocities do not depend upon hearsay. Volumes of sworn depositions still exist in the library of Trinity College, Dublin, to attest the reality of the horrors of that awful time. It is sickening to read them, and worst cannot be set down in print. We can tell of the poor Protestants whose eyes were gouged out of their heads, their hands cut off, and their ears, in fiendish savagery, of men whose bodies the rebels cut slices of flesh and then roasted their victims alive. Of 300 Protestants, men, women and children at Lochgall, stripped naked and driven into the church, the doors locked, and the fierce men, liker wolves or tigers than human beings, let loose upon them daily to kill and outrage as they pleased. Of women broiled on hot gridirons, and men hanged twice or thrice till half dead, then let down and butchered. Of the special cruelties reserved for Protestant ministers, to whom ordinary deaths were in many cases denied as too good. Of some hanged, then dismembered, and their heads cut off, and pieces of their own bodies thrust into the mouths in mockery. of 30 of them massacred in one district, of one hanged at his own church door, another thrown into Loch Ness and drowned, a third, the Reverend Thomas Murray of Killyleagh, who was actually crucified in blasphemous mockery of Calvary between two other Protestant gentlemen. His two sons killed and actually cut to pieces before their mother's eyes. Then her own body, frightfully mutilated, and her tongue cut half out. One can tell of these things, but it is sickening. But worse remains over which a veil must be thrown. In addition, of those actually killed, multitudes perished of cold and hunger in the fields and of sickness to which they were exposed. The numbers of bodies which lay unburied tainted the air. A pestilential fever broke out, of which multitudes died. The abominable and infamous cruelties of this rebellion lie as a terrible blot on the Romish Church. From the beginning, it was the Romish rebellion. Sir Phelim O'Neill declared that, and I quote, he would never leave off the work he had begun till Mass should be sang or said in every church in Ireland, and that a Protestant should not live in Ireland, be he of what nation he would, close quote. The priests joined in planning it and were the foremost in urging it to the utmost extreme. At a meeting in the Abbey of Malty Farham in Westmeath, held about a fortnight before the commencement of the hostilities, some of the clergy present recommended a general massacre as the safest and most effective method of putting down the Protestant ascendancy. Ivor MacMahon, Roman Catholic Bishop of Down and Connor, prompted Sir Phelim O'Neill to the commission of some of his most revolting atrocities. The Roman Catholic clergy of all grades appear upon the stage during the worst scenes of this dismal tragedy.
A Romish bishop was brain of the whole enterprise. The priests commonly anointed the rebels before sending them to their murderous work, assuring them that if they were chanced to be killed, they would escape purgatory and go immediately to heaven. They told the people that the Protestants were worse than dogs. They were devils and served the devil, and the killing of them was a meritorious act. The massacre of 1641 was really an Irish St. Bartholomew, only more terrible and inhumane. And it is no wonder that the scenes we have described have left behind in Ulster a dread amounting almost to terror of ever being placed under the power of Rome again. The lessons to be learned from 1641. The conflict in Ulster is not just one of politics or economics, although political and economic factors are involved. The struggle in these days is basically that of 1641. It is a religious one. The battle is for the very survival of the Protestant way of life, the civil and religious liberty. It is only as loyalists awaken again to the spiritual background and dimension of the conflict that we can begin to anticipate victory. There can be no middle ground in this struggle. The ecumenical fifth column, who hope to buy peace for themselves at any price, in what they now believe to be an inevitable United Ireland, would do well to remember the events of 1641. If we are defeated in this conflict, we will all suffer the same fate. The murderous rebels of 1641 showed no mercy to any Protestant, regardless of age, sex. Neither do the Roman Catholic terrorists of today, who have ravaged our land for the last 40 years. When Roman Catholic Irish nationalists appear to be at their most friendly, they are in fact poised to strike. When the Protestants drop their guard, the Roman Catholic rebels of 1641 feigned friendship to our plantation forefathers right up to the day that the war of genocide began. It was the same in Paris, France, in 1572. The Romanists pledged peace and brotherhood to the Protestant Huguenots, then rose up on St. Bartholomew's Eve to don white armbands and to slay 100,000 of them. Remember how the Roman Catholic Republicans of the Bogside painted up peace slogans in August of 1969, whilst in secret they made their petrol bombs and prepared for their murderous assault upon the Apprentice Boys Parade and upon the security forces. The Belfast and St. Andrews agreements have put these Irish Republican terrorists into the very heart of our government. And this arrangement contains within it the very seeds of our own destruction. 1641 and the repeat thereof is just another compromise away. And if we fail to stand firm, we will seal our own fate, and not only our own, but that of our children and of future generations. We must always be aware that any people that are so willing and able to forget their past are more than too often condemned to relive it.
Dark hung the clouds o'er Erin's sky, black tempest brooded on her deep. In 41, and mournfully, the low wind's nature sighed to sleep. O come to storm, unearthly dread, fell demons through our valleys wide, left naught behind but murdered dead, and rivers flowed with sanguine tide. At midnight hour, when men repose, assassins fiend-like fired each home, while shouts of exultation rose from fortress of papal Rome.
1203 to 1805, 50 million Christians died, suffering at the hands of Rome, because they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel upends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie. With such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord, recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.